Welcome to worship. There's something terribly impressive, isn't there, about things that start slowly and then accelerate. The way a jet plane turns onto the runway, stops sometimes for several minutes, and then starts to roll. And all of a sudden, it's accelerating, and you have the sense of being carried along by immense power, faster and faster, with the rumbling of the undercarriage getting louder and louder, until suddenly it stops, and you're airborne and still accelerating, being carried forward, so it feels, like all the power in the universe. And then there's the ferry. Now, I prefer to think that it's childlike rather than childish, but I find myself sitting, waiting for the crossing to begin, lining up a speck on the window with the edge of the link span in Rothsay or one of the posts on the pier at Weems Bay, watching for the first sign of movement. And then the acceleration begins and the sense of building momentum. And it struck me this year that perhaps that's the key to the way Luke tells the story of Palm Sunday. Momentum, gathering momentum. And it starts with the donkey tied to its post. Now, Jesus clearly has something in mind when he sends the disciples to get the donkey. I've heard the usual rationalizations that Jesus must have arranged in advance with the owners of the donkey, but there's nothing to suggest that Mark or Luke or Matthew want us to understand it so. The sense I'm left with again is of something that's starting to move, and that from the beginning the momentum is there. Go and get a donkey, there'll be one there in that village, bring it to me, just tell whoever owns it that it's for me, it'll be fine. And against every reasonable expectation, it is. The events of Holy Week start to slide friction-free and to gather momentum. The two disciples' hands start loosening the knot that ties the donkey to the post or whatever. But what they're really releasing is the momentum of the Easter story. And it begins to slide, another picture, with the unstoppable momentum of a great ship accelerating down the slipway to its launch. The momentum of the gospel story. No less. Welcome to worship.
Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them, and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord, the righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvellous to our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you. O Lord, O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has given us light. O give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. For his steadfast love endures forever. Let us worship God.
Let us pray. As slow as the trundling donkey, as energetic as the swelling crowd, as thrilling as the chants, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven, glory in the highest heaven, as unstoppable as the most powerful forces of nature, far more powerful than these, the story of your grace and the story of our salvation begins to unfold, loving God.
The love that loved us before we existed has come into the world of time and history. Jesus' route leads through the reality that we live each day. And this is where our salvation lies. The darkness that enslaves the world, the abusive violence that distorts human living, our own capacity as a human family to the things that stop us being the family we should be. The power of these things will be broken on the cross. And to do these things, the gentle King comes, riding on a donkey.
We know and love the story of the love that does these things. And yet we know that we still live between the hope of Christ and the hopelessness of a fallen world. Too often we have compromised. Too often we have fallen short. Too often we have lived in the old stories of hopelessness and despair instead of the new story of liberation, hope and boundless joy that Jesus started as he rode in on that gentle donkey and began to rewrite our human story. Father, forgive us.
But what is the Easter story but the story of your forgiveness? Christ on the cross and the empty grave, in these things is your forgiveness. We proclaim it and believe it. In a week's time, we shall proclaim what has been true for 2,000 years. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. We work our way and walk the paths of the disciples through Holy Week this year. Let our lives proclaim your salvation. Let our joy proclaim your forgiveness. Let our hope proclaim the coming of your kingdom and all things that are made new. Amen.
Crowds. Yet for us from Sunday school days, most of all, it's the donkey who makes us smile. For my generation, more than the palm leaves or shouting Hosanna as loudly as we could in church, it'll be the donkey at the centre of the story that we remember. Now, you might be shocked that I say the donkey at the centre of the story. Surely it's Jesus who should be at the centre of the story, you say. Well, yes, of course, but the donkey really is central because it's the donkey that provides the explanation to people along the way of what's happening as Jesus rides by. That's who this is. I don't know if many of us have ever given any thought to what's happening as Jesus moves off towards Jerusalem on donkeyback. Have we ever wondered how the crowd, the huge crowd that had eventually formed by the time he reached Jerusalem, formed in the first place? Nobody invited them. Nobody tried to draw them in, to whip up their enthusiasm, to get them to join the little band of disciples. Nobody had given them advance notice. There's nothing to suggest that any of this crowd knew that anything was going to happen until they looked up and saw Jesus on the donkey riding by. But when they saw it, they knew it. And they knew because of the donkey. And that's what this is. All Jesus had to do was to sit on the donkey and ride towards Jerusalem, because by doing that, he fulfilled an ancient expectation. I love the boxes that watches and things come in. You know the ones? You open them and there's a silk lining over a hole, a void. That's the shape of a wristwatch or a quaich or whatever the box is for. You know that there's something meant to fit into that hole. Well, the words of Zechariah are like that. They're like the box for something precious. You look at it and you wonder what fits into it. Jesus, by getting on the donkey, is offering himself as what fits into the space, the hole in the middle of Zechariah's prophecy. People see the donkey, they look at Jesus, and they think, yep, that's pretty much an exact fit.
Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you. Triumphant and victorious is he, humble and riding on an ass, on a colt, the foal of the ass. After he had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he had come near Bethphage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of the disciples, saying, go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, why are you untying it, just say this: the Lord needs it. So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners asked them, why are you untying the colt? They said, the Lord needs it. Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it.
Isn't there something strange about those stories of people running down the street shouting, "Stop, thief!" A shopkeeper, perhaps, who had his back turned when some miscreant spotted the till open and saw his chance. Maybe a pickpocket's mark, who actually felt the mobile whisked from his pocket, actually saw who did it, and because he panics and runs, sets off in pursuit, puffing and wheezing and wishing he'd spent more time in the gym. Stop, thief!
Do they really expect the ne'er-do-well to stop? What would happen if he did? Oh, he stopped. What do I do now? What's he going to do? Terribly sorry, old chap. Here's your phone back. Here's the 600 quid I swiped from your till. I only did it because I was short of change and fancied a pizza from the 3-in-1. No hard feelings. It doesn't happen though, does it? Stop, thief. But we know they won't.
What are you doing with that donkey? This is an even odder thing. Suspicious behaviour, suspicious characters and very suspicious owners. Yet nobody shouts, "Stop, thief!" Nobody runs off, or running off with the donkey would be a slow business, though you might think that the suspected donkey rustlers would just have run off without it.
But none of that happens. Instead, the owners of the donkey ask the kind of suspicious question you'd expect. "Oi, what are you doing with Eeyore?" Did you know that there's a list of 50 most popular donkey names in 2021 and that Eeyore is right at the top? And back comes the answer. The master needs him. And that's that. No, okay, no worries. Not a hint that these people knew Jesus or that Jesus had arranged this in advance.
In any case, 2,000 years ago in Judah, there was no vehicle rental. You couldn't phone ahead and book a Michael, Lana, Sid or Gus. They're other popular names from the list. Or an Eeyore. No, what seems to happen is this. People they've never seen before come to take this donkey. The owners challenge them and they're told, "It's for Jesus." Oh, okay. No problemo.
It may seem really odd, but it just feels profoundly right. Just as the little procession trundles on and people see it go by and join it, and their recognition grows, and their sense of the rightness of this deepens, and their excitement begins to bubble over, and they start chanting louder and louder, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord."
The Pharisees are really miffed. "Tell them to shut up," they shout over the happy din. Well, that's a bit daft, isn't it?
They aren't going to shut up any more than somebody running down the street shouting, "Stop, thief," is going to make the thief stop.
Some things just have a momentum of their own, and the accelerating avalanche of people that is Palm Sunday crashes into Jerusalem, sweeping Jesus and the disciples into Holy Week.
Thank you.
reaction is bizarre, isn't it? We don't like what the crowd is shouting, make them stop. As though anybody could. If these were silent, the stones would shout out. This whole thing has a momentum of its own now. And Jesus, from one perspective, seems to be carried along by events. From another perspective, however, well, how shall we put this? It isn't that, as some people put it, Jesus is in control of what's happening. That's a crass misunderstanding based on the most dangerous misconception of all about Jesus, that he's somehow a superhuman superhero with superpowers. Now, what Jesus does is to entrust himself to the meaning of what's happening, to trust that there is a meaning to what's happening. God is in the momentum of these events. Once they've started, you couldn't possibly stop them. The Pharisees can't see that. Jesus does.
Then they brought the colt to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on it, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven." Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop." He answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out."
The Gospels don't present Jesus as any kind of superhero. The Easter story is full of Jesus' humanity, a humanity just like yours and mine. He responds to the crowds. He's not some master puppeteer who has them under a spell. He's angry when he sees the degradation of the temple into a place of commerce. He's anxious and then terrified in the garden before his arrest and feels an aloneness you couldn't miss when he finds the disciples, his friends, fast asleep instead of keeping their watch, or literally looking out for him, as we would say. And he experiences the powerlessness of the political prisoner, which is what he is, of course, as he's beaten. And he shows the profoundest, but also the most profoundly human courage as he rallies and stands before Pilate and talks even then about his kingdom. No, Jesus isn't in control of this unfolding story. He is as vulnerable and as helpless as a human being can be. And we need to know that, because we are vulnerable human beings too. And sometimes we can feel caught up in events that seem to sweep us along with a terrifying momentum of a slow, slow flood. Jesus was there too. And suddenly we have an insight into how strength and weakness and powerlessness and power relate to each other in God. This is simultaneously the story of the powerless, crucified God and the slow but inexorable transforming power of God's love that takes the long way around, the necessary, painful, but only way to the achievement of God's purpose. The momentum of the Easter story is the vast, slow momentum of love playing itself out in the human powerlessness of the incarnate God. That's what the Easter story invites us to trust, and who it invites us to trust: the suffering God of a suffering world whose love overcomes all things. How could we look at the sufferings of Ukraine or the Yemen or any number of places that, God forgive us, we are barely aware of, if we couldn't speak of the suffering God and Easter as his victory? Jesus carried along on the flood of events, the vast slow flow of God's loving purpose, infinitely more powerful than anything that could possibly try to stem or deflect it. You know, there's nothing childish about that donkey. In fact, it takes a childlike insight to see what the disciples set in motion when they untied it.
Prayers of intercession. Let's pray together. Our Father, who is in heaven, on this Palm Sunday, we remember the day Jesus entered Jerusalem. We remember the sacrifice he would make for us. We remember the love he continues to bring us through that sacrifice. But most of all today, We remember that all the authorities on earth could not suppress the joy of that moment in his disciples, of the whole natural world. Even the rocks and stones would refuse to be silenced. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. On this Palm Sunday, we ask you to help us bring your kingdom alive for those around us. Enable us to show your love to all whom we meet. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We pray, Father, that not only do we strive to do your will, but that all people come to see the wisdom of your guidance. Enable us to demonstrate your wisdom through the way we live. Give us this day our daily bread. On this Palm Sunday, we pray for all who are in need, who lack their daily bread, their sustenance. Father, look down on all your people. Send your Holy Spirit to sustain each of us across the world, leading us to exactly what we need each day. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. We know, Father, that you have already forgiven our mistakes. We ask you today to enable all who feel far from love to take a step towards their own peace. Help us to show everyone not only how to forgive others, but also how we forgive ourselves and accept your peace. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. We know, Father, that you will guide us through life's difficulties if we let you. We ask your compassion on those who rely solely on their own judgment, those people in authority who feel they have to protect a way of life, to prevent change and resist living in a new way. You can free everyone from the temptation of self-reliance. Grant us the wisdom to know we will feel your peace when we relinquish self-will. For thine is the kingdom. Living in the kingdom which you have established with us, hear the prayers of our hearts for those known especially to us. We bring them before you in this holy silence. May the power of your love enfold each and every one of the people in our thoughts today. And hear us now, as we say together the words Jesus distilled for us. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We stand at the beginning of Holy Week. Day by day, we shall return to the story we know so well, the story of the world's redemption. May we be drawn deep into the gospel story. May we know anew the slow, vast momentum of God's love. May we entrust ourselves to that love, which, in Jesus Christ, meets us in our weakness, shares all that we must live, and in slow, patient power, brings us through all things to God. The blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you now and evermore. Amen.